Welcome, everyone. My name's Christopher Catta, and I'll be your host this evening. This is the fifth webinar in a series for senior safety strategies for seniors in a program that's been co-sponsored with Caregiving Matters. And this evening, we have a wonderful presentation by Carol Gilmore from the Canadian Anti-Fraud Center's Senior Support Unit. And she's actually filling in for Tom Cheel, who was originally scheduled to present today, but due to some personal matters, wasn't able to. So Carol so graciously stepped in to take over in his absence. And we will be recording the session. And if you do have questions for Carol, you can type them into the Q&A section of Zoom. And towards the end, once Carol's done presenting, we'll go through each of your questions and Carol can respond to them in sequence. And with that, I will turn it over to Carol and she'll take us through the presentation.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you for inviting the Canadian Anti-Fraud Center to have a fraud talk about the top frauds that are targeting seniors online. Scams and cybercrimes can happen to anyone, anywhere, at any time. Victims that report to the Canadian Anti-Fraud Center have told us that they are retired judges, lawyers, law enforcement, doctors, teachers, homemakers. Everyone is a target. The minute that you think that it won't happen to you and you let your guard down, it just might. And the impact of falling victim to fraud can be devastating. You will notice that I will repeat myself and that some of my slides may seem to duplicate warnings and suggestions that will lessen the chance of you becoming a victim of fraud, cybercrime, or identity theft. And I hope that you too will repeat my warnings and suggestions to your family and friends in the hopes of reducing the chance of them becoming victims. Talking about fraud is not taboo or something to keep to yourself. Let's make it a regular topic of conversation with those that we care about. I will provide a handout of fraud awareness for seniors for your host to distribute electronically after this presentation. So if you think you have to write down a website or a phone number, just know I will include everything in this presentation in the handout. My next slide shows that there are many faces of fraud: the victims and the amount of money that they lost. Oops. As fraud rates continue to increase in Canada, the world is going through a global pandemic with waves and variants. This has created an environment that is ripe for fraud and online criminal activity. The COVID-19 has resulted in never-before-seen numbers of people turning to the internet for their groceries, everyday shopping, banking, and sometimes for companionship. Coupled with the profound social, psychological, and emotional impacts, the pool of potential victims has increased dramatically. This fraud talk will cover the Canadian Anti-Fraud Center, the top cyber frauds, tips on how to stay safe online, and reduce the chances of being victimized. We'll talk a little bit about identity theft and the importance of reporting fraud. The Canadian Anti-Fraud Center is a joint forces operation led by the RCMP in partnership with the Ontario Provincial Police and Competition Bureau of Canada. Day-to-day operations are led by the RCMP, and the Canadian Anti-Fraud Center headquarters is located in North Bay, Ontario. It is Canada's National Fraud Reporting Center and takes a victim-centered approach to supporting Canadian consumers and businesses affected by fraud. We are the only Canada Central Sourcing Mass Marketing Fraud Intel. In addition to taking reports from victims of fraud, the information collected at the Canadian Anti-Fraud Centre plays a vital role in developing awareness campaigns and supporting law enforcement efforts to investigate and disrupt criminals behind the scams. As well, the Canadian Anti-Fraud Centre strengthens partnerships between private and public sectors with the aim of maintaining Canada's strong economy. So let's talk about a little bit about what fraud is. It's a global issue with serious financial consequences. Whenever a criminal sets out to mislead, lie, deceive, or not give a consumer what they have been promised, it's fraud. Mass marketing fraud deals with frauds that target the masses. Usually, it's organized crime with a well-orchestrated web of deceit that sets out to steal money and or personal information from hundreds of thousands of victims. They usually don't get too greedy, which allows them to stay under the radar and work across borders to elude law enforcement. Scams and cybercrimes can happen to anyone, anywhere, at any time. If you have been a victim of a scam, fraud, or cybercrime, please call your local police. Let them know you're a senior victim of fraud and wish to file a report. Have all your supporting documents in order. And remember that it is the role of your local police to investigate. The Canadian Anti-Fraud Centre assists law enforcement agencies through maintaining a central database of information to assist with those investigations. This slide mentions that one of the elements of fraud is deceit. My next slide is going to show us that some things are not as they seem. We have to be alert at all times. So this next video clip moves very quickly. So here we go. So there's nothing funny about fraud and deception, but sometimes it doesn't hurt to inject a little humor into a very serious conversation. Deception in the blink of an eye or by the click of your mouse can happen before you know it. This slide shows that the Canadian Anti-Fraud Centre receives calls from people talking about romance, service, investment, prize, bank investigator scams. The first column shows the number of reports that we received, either by telephone or online. The next column shows the number of victims and the dollar loss. I will briefly explain the top three. Romance scams are at an all-time high. Romance fraudsters are making more money than ever before. Sending money to someone you have not met for love or friendship is a risky move. You not only lose your money, but your heart and trust in someone that you were sure loved you back. The next fraud pitch, the service scams, there are a variety of service scams reported to the Canadian Anti-Fraud Centre. Some of the most common service scams that are initiated online deal with an offer to help you with government documents for a fee. There could be a website offer that will say that they can get you a passport or a birth certificate or book a road test, or the website may promise faster processing times or other guarantees. The reality is that the forms needed to get government identification are free. No one can speed up the process. So that's one service scam that's reported to us. Another one is immigration websites, where scammers create fake websites and online ads that offer cheap immigration services or may guarantee high-paying jobs. Many of the websites will look very, very official, and they may even steal government logos to give them an air of legitimacy. But beware if they're asking you to pay an application access fee or deposit before the application is even started. Other ones may offer you a low interest rate on your credit cards. Keep in mind that the only person that can lower your interest rates is your own credit card company. They may say that they could get you a pardon for a fee. They will get you a pardon or a criminal record waiver. They may promise faster processing times and other guarantees. But the reality is the forms required to obtain a pardon are free. No one can speed up the waiver process. You may be contacted by somebody saying that they can resell perhaps automobile, timeshares, rentals, or property listings. Typically, you'll be targeted after posting something yourself for sale online, but the scammer claims to have a buyer and other offers to help sell your item, but you must pay them. Before you know it, there is no buyer and your money is gone. Also, very well-known service scam is the fake tech support. A scammer claims a virus has infected your computer. The communication might have happened through an alarming website pop-up that demands that you call a number urgently. Or it might be an unsolicited telephone call claiming to be Microsoft or another well-known company. And a scammer will state that your computer is sending out viruses or has been hacked and must be serviced. They ask you to pay a fee for fixing your computer, usually by credit card or a money transfer. In some cases, the scammer takes over your computer, gets you to log into your bank account, and helps you transfer the funds to them. So keep in mind that Microsoft isn't calling anybody. That if there is something wrong with your computer, you know, take it to a local reputable service technician and have it scanned for any type of malware or spyware. The third one is talking about investment scams. It's any solicitation for investments into a false or deceptive investment opportunity. These opportunities promise higher than normal returns. However, we only hear from investors that lose most or all of their money. Hot investment schemes these days involve cryptocurrency. Always check with your provincial securities commission to see what the current regulations are before investing. This slide talks about the tools of the trade. In order for the fraud to be successful, fraudsters require a way to communicate with their potential victims, as well as a system to receive payment from victims. To better prevent fraud from the beginning, it's important to be aware of the top contact methods and best practices will follow. For the sake of this presentation, I'm going to focus on cyber crimes, but often frauds will start out online and then switch to a direct call. So even though the direct call is showing us here 47%, it could be that the scam is started by an email and then they exchange phone numbers and then it turns into direct calls. So just know that even though we're able to give you these stats, many of them overlap. So the first one we'll talk about is the tool that they use, which could be your cell phone. The cell phone has evolved into today's mobile device that can fit into your pocket and can allow you to call and in most cases connect online with anyone across the globe. It is the number one reported tool reported to the Canadian Anti-Fraud Center that the fraudsters are using to victimize good and trusting seniors like yourself. The advancement of technology allows fraudsters access to automated dialing, robocalls, spoofing, and delayed disconnect on landlines. Firstly, I'll explain a little bit about automated dialing. It allows software that automatically dials numbers in sequence. The phone numbers are usually provided from large lists. Once the call is answered, the auto dialer either plays a recorded message or connects the call to a live person. These systems can be used for legitimate and or fraudulent call centers. Fraudsters may use a list of phone numbers gained legally or illegally, or they may have set up the dialer to call all possible configurations of phone numbers in a given region. Robocalls are calls that use an auto dialer to deliver a pre-recorded message. The recorded message may use a computerized robotic voice or that of a real person. Robocalls are subject to the CRTC regulations. If you are registered on Canada's Do Not Call List registry, it should filter out a large number of unsolicited and unwanted calls. The National Do Not Call List gives a consumer a choice about whether to receive telemarketing calls, but we have to keep in mind that some are exempt, and we encourage you to go to the Do Not Call List registry and read more about it. Spoofing calls allow your caller ID or call display that normally indicates the phone number and name associated to the line used to call you. There are a number of legitimate purposes for altering the information provided on caller ID, but unfortunately, there are just as many illegitimate reasons for fraudsters to manipulate the information displayed. The most common misrepresentation is to trick Canadians into answering calls by using the same area code to make it appear that the call is local. It may mirror your own phone number, and it may display a recognized number of a specific organization, such as law enforcement, government agency, sometimes a bank, or showing a phone number that cannot be redialed. So just be really careful of that. One time I picked up a call, this was about a decade ago, it was showing my phone number, and I thought, really? So I picked it up, and before I know it, I was listening to Toot Toot. It's my captain calling, and I'd won a vacation. So I knew right then and there that that it wasn't as it seemed, that's for sure. The next one I'm going to talk about, even though we're talking about cyber crimes, is the delayed disconnect, which can happen on a landline only. And when trying to legitimize their call, fraudsters will sometimes ask you to end the current call and immediately call the number on the back of your credit card or your debit card or another number that they provide to you. When you complete the second call, you are almost instantly connected to the same person you are just speaking with. And that is because the original call was never completely disconnected. So if ever you have to hang up before you redial again, you know, give it a good minute, or if there's another phone or a calling device in your home, we suggest that you use it, and that way you won't fall victim to a criminal taking advantage of a delayed disconnect. Some fraud is initiated by email or text message. In this case, they're spoofing, and just like caller ID spoofing, the fraudsters are also able to alter the sender's information in emails and text messages. They use spoofing tactics to display a name or a number that they didn't want you to see. In emails, you should be able to hover over a sender's name, and it should reveal a true email address. And if there's a discrepancy, if there's, you know, one little digit off or a letter, then there's something to be very, very careful as you go forward. And we would suggest that you don't respond to any email like that and take the time to report it. Automation or scheduled emails and text messages were designed to help businesses save time by quickly and simultaneously engaging with their contact list. But fraudsters use the same application and services to instantly message their contact list, and they can choose who messages to go out to, decide when to send them, and even personalize them depending on the information they have previously collected. Fraudsters may also set up autoresponders and send delayed messages, for when consumers reply back. And the last one on this slide is email compromise. When fraudsters gain access to email accounts, they can impersonate the victim to attempt fraud. With consumers' accounts, fraudsters may send an email to the victim's entire contact list asking for money urgently due to an emergency. The fraudsters may send repeated invoices to clients or consumers asking them to submit payment or click on a link to update their bank account. They may also impersonate an executive and request payments from staff members for various reasons. The success of these frauds depends on the fraudster's ability to spoof the victims. So just to be very, very careful, an email or a text message that includes a sense of urgency is a telltale sign of fraud. Always take the time to verify again with a trusted source. Do not click any links or attachments if you're unsure of the sender's identity. The internet is a network of electronic devices that span the globe. It is easy to connect, and once online, you can access almost any information or communicate with anyone else that is connected. It is the perfect workplace for fraudsters. They will take advantage of search engine optimization. When looking for information online, many consumers will use a popular search engine to find answers quickly. Fraudsters will often pay for their information or websites to be listed in the top results. If your search says ad, A-D, you'll want to keep scrolling down until you find the main secure website with a padlock or a HTTPS in the address bar. Also, online, you may receive a pop-up. Pop-ups are used to grab your attention and are known to have a reputation as annoying distractions. A few variations exist where popovers will appear on top of your current page. Pop-ups will redirect you to a new window or tab, and pop-ups under will open a new window or tab, but will not redirect you from the current window. There are three ways that you can trigger a pop-up. A time-driven pop-up, they're set up to appear after you've clicked something, and it sets a timer in the background. And once it's elapsed, there may be also behavior-driven pop-ups, which will appear after specific conditions have been met. And exit pop-ups will appear when you close your browser or visit a website different than the current one. So there's all kinds of distractions, but if you can just promise yourself going forward that you'll never ever click on a pop-up. If there is something that interests you, we suggest that you close out of what you're in or open a new window and go to the secured site to take a look and see if they really are offering what was on that pop-up. We also might come across online classifieds where fraudsters camouflage themselves amongst popular bargain hunting grounds. They will create advertisements for items such as animals, rentals, vehicles for sale, and list them at a discount. Fraudsters may also contact consumers saying that they are interested in purchasing their item and offer an overpayment. In some cases, they may take over a victim's account or offer false employment for others to post advertisements for them. So just to be aware of that, and always, if something is unsolicited, take your time to go to the real website. If you have to use your username and password, and enter it to see whether or not somebody is trying to fraudulently take advantage of you. We also have fake websites. Creating websites can be quick and easy, yet they may not be up for long if they're flagged to be fraudulent. Fraudsters create websites for a number of frauds. They're all built to offer a sense of trust and legitimacy behind the information they have provided. You have to realize that fraudsters may also purchase HTTPS precursors to indicate that their website is secure when transferring information. They may also purchase domain names that are very close to legitimate brands, especially when they're claiming to be affiliated to a business or when they're looking to sell counterfeit merchandise. As well, fake information. Fraudsters will create accounts and websites using stolen logos, information, and photos of real people and/or merchandise. Some frauds are initiated on social networks. Social media was designed to allow users to create and share content, as well as participate in social networking. The most popular websites or applications in Canada are Facebook, YouTube, dating websites, Instagram, Pinterest, Twitter, Snapchat, LinkedIn. So please be aware that these fraudsters are on all these platforms and they're able to create fake accounts where fraudsters will create their accounts typically using stolen photos and information from legitimate people. Most recently, Facebook announced that between January and March, it removed 2.19 billion fake accounts from their platform. So if you notice any fake accounts, make sure that you, on any of the social networking platforms, let them know, and hopefully they will shut them down, which will lessen the chance of other consumers becoming victims. As well, you should be aware of social media bots. This type of bot uses fake accounts to automatically generate and amplify specific messaging, such as advertising and fake reviews. These may mostly be used to create convincing personas capable of influencing us. Since bots are automatic, they work 24/7. Compromised accounts is when the fraudster gains access to a social media account. They also gain access to all the information associated to the account. If they find compromising information, photos of the victim, they may blackmail them. Additionally, they will be likely to impersonate the victim and attempt frauds against the victim's contact list. Fraudsters may send messages to all the victim's contact list, informing them that they found their name on a winner's list or for money urgently due to help out. And they may also use these accounts to publish their fake ads. In advertisements, the fraudsters recognize that consumers spend a lot of time on social media and will post ads for free trials, discounted merchandise, or fake job opportunities. They may also use the names and photos of well-known individuals or companies to fake endorsements and/or their product. So again, if you take the time to say, oh yes, well, I'm interested in learning more about that and going to a secure website that you are aware of instead of hitting a link or a pop-up or something that you see on Facebook, that's our suggestion. Do not accept requests from people that you do not know. You do not know if they have any malicious intent. Be very wary of profiles that seem perfect in their photos. And there is a website that you can go to. It's called TinEye, and you can do a reverse search to see if the same photo is being used online for different frauds and or where that photo originated. So be wary of those who always have an excuse why you can't meet in person, and never, ever send money to someone that you have not met. Beware of profiles that do not have many friends connected to it. Or if somebody is harassing or threatening you, take a look at the security and remove and/or block and report their account. spot other fake accounts when they have a high follower count but low engagement. The engagement rate is too fast, and they have a large following but very few posts. More than likely, they have used a special software to make accounts look legitimate and make them look good. But just know that there's lots of warning signs and red flags that should be going off if you notice any of that type of activity. Fraudsters use every type of dating or social networking site available to contact their victims. Their accounts are created using photos, as I mentioned, stolen from legitimate people, sometimes celebrities. Their background stories often mimic the victims, and they are often say that they're in the military, they work overseas, or they're successful business people, and they can't meet right away personally. They quickly profess their love and gain victims' trust and affection and money. This type of fraud relies heavily on victims' emotions and may last for months, years, or until the victim has nothing left to give. The fraudsters will always run into trouble and are unavailable to refund their victims. However, they will continue to make empty promises and keep asking for more and more money. These days, we're seeing romance frauds morphing into investment schemes offering high returns on cryptocurrency and/or extortion if they've shared intimate photos. Oftentimes, when we speak with victims reporting fraud, it's very complex. The fraudsters have wove a web of deceit that leads from one fraud right into another. Many victims say that they feel that they were put in a trance, that they believed their online lover more than the advice of family, friends, their trusted banker, police, their investment advisors, and even the CAFC. These fraudsters are professional con artists and will stop at nothing to get a victim's money and/or personal information. We suggest that people take the time to verify, verify, and verify again. Do an open search on the internet, as other victims may have posted warnings online. Listen to your family and friends. They have nothing to lose, but you do. And this slide is just showing one arrest that was reported by Global News on how 11 victims in the Edmonton area lost $1.1 million to a fraudster, and they were able to make an arrest, and they all started through a networking site called LinkedIn. But it could have happened anywhere, on any dating site, off of Facebook, off of Words with Friends. People get friendly, strike up a conversation, and one thing leads to the other. And it's always money and or personal information that may put you at risk for identity theft. The tech support scam, oftentimes you may have seen this type of pop-up. And so what Microsoft wants you to know is that any error or warning message that they send to you would never, ever include a phone number. So beware of these type of pop-ups telling you not to turn off your computer, but give them a call, especially if it's unsolicited. Or warning messages that they've spotted a critical problem with your computer and that they need access to your computer in order to fix it. Some cases, the victims have said that there's a demanding, intimidating voice that's come through their computer advising them to call a number. So if this happens to you, what should you do? Well, you should restart your device and don't click on any of the links. Unsolicited phone calls or messages warning that they've spotted a critical problem with your computer, just delete them, press your Control Alt Delete, go into your task manager and delete that and close it down so that you're not tempted to click on it, because it might be a time scheduled. Well, it keeps popping up and it keeps popping up, and you think you have to click on it to make it go away. So again, don't click on any links or call any numbers. And of course, don't give anybody remote access to your computer if it's unsolicited. But if you have already clicked, then we suggest that you run security scans and diagnostics. Make sure your antivirus is up to date. And if you're not computer savvy, take your device to a local certified technician and have your computer cleaned. Investment scams, we talked a little bit about that. This picture shows a boiler room that criminals use to take advantage of unsuspecting, good and trusting seniors like yourself that offer higher than normal or true monetary returns. Unfortunately, victims in a lot of cases lose most or all of their money before they realize that they've been taken advantage of. So this boiler room was reported in a Ukrainian news September 28th, 2021, and it says that the security service of the Ukraine took down a network of 6 call centers used by a ring of scammers to defraud cryptocurrency investors worldwide. Fraudsters behind these illegal call centers used a VoIP phone, a voice over internet protocol, to hide their location while they were scamming thousands of foreign investors. Scammers are always finding new ways to steal your money using cryptocurrency. By that, a popular one is Bitcoin. I'm not sure if you've heard of that before, but if ever you are offered that or you see a pop-up, that sounds too good to be true, just really take the time to check it out with our Ontario Securities Commission, or you can call the Canadian Anti-Fraud Centre and ask us what we know about that fraud. Also, in investment scams, it could be a pyramid, similar to a Ponzi scam. A pyramid scam focuses primarily on generating profits by recruiting other investors. A common pyramid scam today takes the form of a gifting circle. Participants gift a sum of money to join and ultimately must recruit others to make their money back. These schemes may offer products, but they usually have a very little value. Pyramid selling is illegal in Canada. It's a criminal offense to establish, operate, advertise, or promote a scheme of pyramid selling. So be very, very careful when asked to provide personal or financial information upfront to reclaim any of your lost investment profits, as that would be part of a recovery pitch where they're going to try and get more money from you to get back something that they're not able to do. Beware of opportunities offering higher than normal returns. Beware of any urgency pressuring you to make an investment so that you don't miss out. Prior to investing, ask for information on the investment, then take the time to research by verifying the information. Verify, verify, verify. I can't say that enough. Verify with the Securities Commission. Verify with your investment person. Verify with the Canadian Anti-Fraud Center before you agree to anything or give any of your personal information or money up front. This is my attempt of putting a little humor again into a very serious conversation. But typically, while this cartoon is humorous, phishing can download malware onto your device and or lead to identity theft, which is anything but funny for the victims. Phishing is just a numbers game to fraudsters. How many consumers will take the bait and click? So again, if I receive something, perhaps from my bank, ask me to put in my account number, I would X out of it. I would go to my bank's secure website, put in my username and password, and go in and contact them through that method to see if they were really looking for my information for whatever reason. So phishing emails use a technique that's used to trick the victim into thinking that they're dealing with a reputable company. A lot of us were buying and selling online through the pandemic and continue to do so. And oftentimes these criminals, coincidence or not, you'll get a notice that something's being sent to you. And you're thinking, well, yes, of course, I ordered something online. I'll just click that link and see what's going on. But our advice is don't click those links. By hovering over the from line, you may see an address that you would think was UPS, but in fact, it has an @hotmail.com, @gmail, where a UPS email would never have a free service extension. So just keep that in mind. Just take the time to take a look at things. If I wanted to know if UPS was sending me something, I would go to the secure UPS, see and contact them and see if they're delivering something to me, or go to the vendor that I purchased this from and asked if they had used UPS and from there go to UPS to track my package. So this would be a perhaps an unsolicited email. So again, the advice is absolutely do not click. Look for spelling and formatting errors and verify the hyperlink behind the text or the button in the text. As I mentioned, just hover your mouse over the from line and or any links within the message to see where you may be directed. So again, this slide is showing the URL and what happened when the person that was targeted hovered on the https://login.microsoftonline.com. When they hovered on that, it had a completely different HTTPS. And down in the body of the email, when they hovered over the verify account, the blue rectangular square there, there was a complete redirect. It wasn't to Microsoft at all. So those are just a couple things to keep very much in mind when you're online. Fraudsters may place advertisements on popular classified sites or social networking, as we've spoken about. They may also create websites that share the look and feel of legitimate manufacturers. And fraudsters will generate traffic to their products by advertising them at deep discounts. Consumers may receive counterfeit products, lesser valued, and or other unrelated goods, or they might receive nothing at all. Additionally, businesses should do due diligence before purchasing products and or services from new and unknown suppliers. So this one that I'm showing you here is an authentic versus a fake Canada Goose patch. And when you're looking to make some purchases online, you can actually go to the Real Canada Goose website and they will show you what to look for in fakes, so that before you make the purchase or before you give the fake website your credit card number and information, that you will know what you're looking for and hopefully won't be fooled. And so when you're shopping online, you should be very careful that if you don't get what you've been promised, to take immediate steps to let your credit card provider know, to let the Real Canada Goose know if that's what you were purchasing, that let the Canadian Anti-Fraud Centre know so that we can take steps to disrupt the criminal and lessen the chance of other people being victimized. If you get something and it's not as advertised, don't think, oh, I should have known better. You know, take the time to report it, and let's shut these merchants down, and let's shut these websites down so that they don't have the opportunity to fleece somebody else. As well, you might get a fake Canada Goose jacket and not even know that it is counterfeit if you're not aware of what to look for. In a lot of counterfeit products, they could be, it could cause a health hazard. The zippers could be made of lead. Some people have ripped apart the fake Canada Goose jackets and found feces and other stuffing in it that might be a health hazard to somebody. So just know, you know, take the time to report it. Make sure that what you've bought is what you expected. And take the time to report it. I can't say that enough. In this next slide, we're taking a look at a recent email that a victim received from somebody that they knew and that they trusted. And again, we caution you on emails that receive that ask you to act immediately. It might come as a text or an email. And if you receive such an email, such as this one, we suggest that you contact the person that sent it to you by another means, such as a direct call, to verify if the request is real. It could be that their email has been compromised and a request has been sent to everyone on their contact list. If that's the case, they will want to take the steps to change their passwords, run a virus scan, as well as an anti-malware scan and or a full scan on their computer. Or it could be that your computer is infected with malware that sends this scam message to you, hoping that you're going to respond to the fraudster. So always remember, as I said, to hover on the from email. In this case, it looked like it was coming from a Rick. But really, you are going to be redirected to a janekelly722@gmail.com. Just when you think that it couldn't get any worse, all initial victims of the fake tech support scam were recontacted by the fraudsters and told them that they would be getting their money back. And all they had to do was give remote access and they would refund the money that they lost to the tech support scam. They were so convincing that many Canadians fell for the recovery pitch and either sent more money or gave remote access again to their computer by the fraudster. So if you've recently been a victim of a scam, you may want to watch out for the recovery pitch. Victims may be at risk of being targeted again by the same scammer in the hopes of getting additional funds, or the scammer may have sold your name and contact information to another organized crime group that will target you with a completely different scam. So you really want to take as much time as you can to protect yourself from cybercrime. Don't respond to unsolicited offers. Protect your online account by setting up a two-factor authentication. Use strong passwords. Don't be afraid to say no. Don't click on pop-ups. Do your research. Make sure your computer is well protected. Be careful who you share images and personal information with online. Always take the time to verify, verify, and verify again. Oftentimes, if you've paid a fraudster, they've asked you to send it by a money service business, such as Western Union or MoneyGram. They may have asked you to put cash in an envelope and send it by a courier. They may ask you to find a Bitcoin ATM in your community and put your cash in it and send it to a Bitcoin wallet number. They may ask you for a credit card, a debit card, or a very popular method is the gift cards. So just be aware, if somebody tells you to keep something a secret, it's a huge red flag. If you've paid with a credit card or a debit card, we suggest you contact the company or the bank immediately and let them know what's happened. Canadian credit cards have zero liability. We don't know of any victim of fraud that has used their credit card and has been misled and deceived and hasn't been able to get their money back from their credit card company. So we strongly encourage you when you're dealing with companies to use your credit card, because you will have an avenue to dispute it. If you send the cash or the gift card or by money service business, it's very difficult. The chances are slim to none that you will be able to get your money back. If you have paid with a gift card, contact the company that issued the gift card. Tell them it was used in a scam and ask if they can refund your money. Keep the gift card itself and the receipt. If a scammer has remote access to your computer, we suggest that you update your security software, run computer scans, and delete anything that identifies as a problem. You can also take other steps to protect your personal information. If you're not computer savvy, find a local licensed service technician and let them know what's happened to you. Did the scammer take control of your cell phone account? We suggest right away you contact the service provider to take back control of your phone immediately. Time is of the essence. If you try to log in and can't, don't put it off. Call your provider right away. And once you do, change your password. Also check your credit card, bank, and other financial accounts for any unauthorized charges or changes. If you see any, report them to the company and or institution. And then you can go right to our website, www.antifraudcenter.ca, to see what next steps to take. This slide, again, is injecting a little humor into our serious fraud talk this evening. Identity theft occurs when a victim's personal information is stolen or compromised. This can happen as a result of volunteering personal information or financial information, a phishing email, a stolen wallet, a database breach. The list goes on and on. Identity fraud occurs when the fraudster uses that information for a fraudulent activity. They could create fake identity documents, submit unauthorized credit card applications, open up financial accounts in your name, reroute your mail, purchase mobile phones, take over your existing financial and or social accounts. The impact of identity theft and fraud can be overwhelming. It will take time to reestablish your credit. If the fraudsters misused your SIN number, your tax refund could be delayed or cause a negative impact on your health, causing stress and anxiety levels to rise. As well, victims may feel shame or embarrassed about how their information was stolen. Victims may feel rejected or mistrusted by companies that they deal with or family. It leads to anger and frustration and stress. Family and work suffers. I mentioned two things to really keep in mind is the security of your computer. Everybody should know how to run a scan. And if you don't, make sure that you have a local reputable service technician or a family member that's tech savvy to show you the security on your computer. As well, dual authentication. Sometimes it's called two-factor or multi-factor authentication. If you can add that level of security to any of your accounts, we suggest that you do. And what that means is that if a fraudster was going to log into maybe one of your social networking accounts like Facebook, if you had set up dual authentication, you would get a notification right away that somebody or a different device has logged in. If it was you, you can disregard the warning. But if it wasn't you, then you could take immediate steps to make sure that that you're going to be protected, change your passwords, and that was that. I'm not sure if you're familiar with this website. It's a common one that's available to all consumers. It's for database breaches. You can go to haveibeenpawned.com and put in either your email or your phone number. And what will happen is it will search and let you know if your email or number has been involved in a database breach. So for an example, I put in my home email address and it said, oh no, Pond, that I was involved in one database breach. And in this one in particular, it was my Words with Friends account. It stated that in September 2019, Zynga, who is the game developer and creator of Words with Friends, suffered a database breach. It said that it exposed 173 million unique email addresses alongside usernames and passwords that were stored on the site. And it told me that my email address, my password, my phone number, and my username was compromised. Knowing that, if I had used my password for multiple accounts, I could be in some serious trouble. And so that's another reason for strong passwords and not to use the same password for multiple accounts, because the criminal with this database breach could have sent me another email pretending to be my bank. And then if I clicked on it, they might think, okay, Carol has a Royal Bank account. I'll go in with the username and password that she uses on her Scrabble Words with Friends game. And Bob's your uncle. They're into my account. Now, if I had set up two-factor authentication, I would automatically be notified probably on my cell phone that somebody had logged in on a different device into my banking. So I would take immediate steps to protect myself. I did take the time just for fun to enter in Alex's name, who I worked with to set up this presentation. And Alex, if you're online, you'll be happy to know good news that your home email address has not been involved in any breached accounts. Fraud is very underreported. Victims often don't report fraud because they feel ashamed or embarrassed. They might have the perception that no one will believe them or that law enforcement won't investigate. They may have the fear of family taking control of finances and they might lose their financial independence. They may not even realize that they've been a victim of fraud, or they may blame themselves for their losses. And in some cases, if they think that they can't get their money back, they think, why report it? But we do encourage all victims to report fraud. We have these steps on our website. So we want you to, you know, step number one, gather all your information pertaining to the fraud. If you've given personal information, you'll want to contact our two major credit report bureaus, Equifax and TransUnion. They deal independently, so you have to make sure that you reach both of them. Step number three, your local law enforcement. Step four, the Canadian Anti-Fraud Center. Then your financial statements and notify them of any suspicious activity. If you feel that somebody's redirecting mail, Canada Post, depending on personal information that was compromised, federal agencies or provincial agencies. And local MP and MPPs need to know that senior victims are falling victim to fraud and what's going on. By applying pressure on our MP and MPPs, we can get changes to legislation in the hopes that there will be laws and new regulations that will protect consumers and seniors online. I've talked about reporting to the Canadian Anti-Fraud Centre. We do have a toll-free line and or an easy online fraud reporting system. And there's a little picture of our website, and highlighted is report a fraud. The Canadian Anti-Fraud Centre is currently working in partnership with a new RCMP National Crime Cybercrime Coordination Unit, referred to as NC3. And a lot of people have reported to us that our fraud reporting online system needed some work and it wasn't user-friendly. So hopefully soon we will be able to release a new online database working with NC3 that will make it easier for all Canadians to report fraud. Now, when you report fraud to us, we have an operational support unit that takes the suspect telephone numbers, the suspect email addresses, the websites, the credit card numbers that you share with us, the merchant accounts, meaning on the descriptor line of your credit card, who it was that actually charged you, the bank account numbers that you may have wired transferred money to. So in 2020, the Canadian Anti-Fraud Centre shut down 1,185 suspect phone numbers. So that takes that tool away from the fraudster. Probably not for long. They'll probably have new numbers and up and running, you know, before we can blink an eye, but any potential victims that were communicating with them on that phone number, and they thought that maybe they were dealing with the government or their bank, and all of a sudden it's not in service, hopefully it'll give them pause to stop and reconsider what they're being offered and take the time to verify again. So we all need to be vigilant. Fraudsters want to profit from consumers' fears, uncertainties, and misinformation. The Canadian Anti-Fraud Centre's slogan for fraud prevention is geared towards getting Canadians to slow down and not react to potential fraud solicitations. We encourage people to recognize that fraudsters are using every means at their disposal to target them. Telephone, email, text messaging, social media, internet, and mail. We ask that they change how they react to unsolicited offers and/or demands. We ask that they reject fraud involving their personal information and/or money. Routine practices to develop include checking your credit profile once a year. All Canadians can apply for a free copy of their credit profile and dispute any activity that they didn't initiate. We encourage people to monitor their accounts for any unauthorized activities, update their operating systems and antivirus software, and not do any unsolicited business over the phone or internet. Again, we want people to slow down, to think about and assess a situation before reacting. This can involve saying no, doing due diligence, researching and confirming information, and talking to family members, friends, and trusted advisors. We want to encourage people to take their time and scrutinize all offers and demands. Reporting fraud means speaking up, even when no money was lost. Like other crimes, if fraud is not reported, we don't know what's happening and we can't warn other people. The information from one fraud occurrence, a bank account, an email address, a virtual currency address, telephone number, can be investigated, and it's useful in linking other occurrences to when a person and or an organization is arrested. It is used to show a judge a pattern of deceit when and if they get them in front of a judge in a court of law. Moreover, reporting provides other opportunities for disruption, such as my previous slide shows. I've taken up a lot of your time. Thank you for your patience, and I'm open to questions.
Thank you so much, Carol. That was absolutely fantastic. I want to thank everyone for joining in, and we do have a few minutes. If there are any questions, you can type them into the Q&A section in Zoom, and then we'll have Carol answer those for us. So while we wait and see if any questions come through, I do want to remind everyone that this is the fifth out of six webinars that are in this series on the safety strategies for seniors. And if you're interested in attending the next webinar, it's happening on Monday, November 15th at 7 p.m. And it's on the topic of fall prevention with Linda and Chats. So we hope to see you there on that webinar as well. So I don't see any questions, Carol, but I do appreciate that you're going to share the slide deck with everyone. So we will be making that available through the Caregiving Matters website, along with a link to the recording of Carol's presentation today.
Perfect. Thank you so much, and stay safe out there.
Thank you. Bye for now, everyone.